everybody, and welcome to the Winter Quarter Sleeve Play production. Hi, Keegan. We are your directors, AJ.
And Josie. It's great to be back bringing Sleeve Play part two of probably part three, but we'll see how it goes. We want to start by just giving some major shout outs to people who, without them, this production wouldn't have happened. Adrian and Clem.
Our producers, they did everything. You'll note that for a Sleeve Play, the production quality is mighty high, if I do say so myself.
For $50, we really pulled through. Tiger, Kathy, yeah. Theodora did our costumes. There's heavy costumes in the show. Thank them if you see them.
Okay, so this is a little weird, but some of you weren't here in the fall. And oddly enough, like Peter, oddly enough, that is actually crucial. So what happened in the fall? We put on this bizarre remake of Lysistrata, a Greek, is it a comedy or a drama? Who can tell, really? But the premise is that they withhold sex to try to instigate peace. Our version involved a director, Joe Dandy, who bears, I really want to emphasize this point,
zero. No
resemblance to a real human being despite names that might sound alike. Joe Dandy is a fictional character. We really do mean this point.
There really are a lot of things you can do with
this. Right. So, Joe Dandy was the director of the theoretical play Lysistrata. And the primary lead in that play was an actress by the name of Lucy Stratford. If you look on the back of your programs, since that happened, many things happened. She tried to make a sequel, and it bombed. You can read it all on the box office. This is a true story.
It really is.
So, today you're going to be seeing a reprise of these roles, Brian Morris, Duncan Coleman. We have a lot of actors that are new too, which is gonna be great, a bunch of new faces. We encourage all the Sleeve kids in this room to also join us for the spring. Everyone except for Joe Dandy is based on a real character. Okay? They really are. We really think these are honest depictions of literally every other character in this play. This is a comedy, please laugh.
Please laugh, guys. Just
more than you did just
yes.
now. And that is everything. Thank you guys so much for showing up. We hope you enjoyed the show.
We present you there.
Friends, we are gathered today to mourn the loss of Miss Lucinda Stratford. Miss Stratford was many things to many people. She was a sister, a daughter, a friend, and a lover. But to most people, Miss Stratford was first and foremost an actress. She made her acting debut in a gender-flipped version of Medea as Jason, followed by a well-received one-woman version of Sophocles' Theban plays, wherein the central conflict of sexual tension was artfully reworked into a testament to self-love. Silence! This is a funeral! More recently, following her role in the successful modern remake, Lysistrata, whose title sounds weirdly similar to her name, Lucy Stratford, she ventured into directing with Lysistrata 2 in space. A radical attempt to go where no modern setting of an ancient Greek play had ever gone before. But as Lysistrata 2 in space was a monumental failure, I reiterate now that we should think of Miss Stratford as, first and foremost, an actress.
What burdens you today, my son? Forgive me, father, for I have sinned. And what is your sin, my son?
I am engaged in sloth. Ever since the death of the love of my life, nothing has any meaning for me. I can't sleep. I can't eat. I am never happy. I'm only halfway through the journey of my life. And I'm in a really dark place right now.
It's almost as if you have lost the straight way.
Yeah, that's one way to put it.
What was the name of your love?
Lucy.
Lucy. I'm sure you miss Lucy very much. God allows us all to experience loss, and we can endure the suffering and the mourning so long as we allow it to help us realize our need for divine... Wait, did you say Lucy? Lucy Stratford, the writer of that awful movie, In Space?
I mean, I'd really rather think of her as first and foremost an actor.
So, I think I can help you out.
What? How do you know my name?
I can stop you from taking the pears, so to speak.
Why do you sound like St. Augustine?
Pleasure to meet you.
What?
Come on out.
Wait, but you're dead.
That evil prison of Satan you call a body is dead, but in soul I am more alive than ever before.
What are you doing here?
I have good news for you, Joe. Well, good news and bad news. I assume you want the bad news first.
Love of my life is dead. What news could be worse than that?
That the love of your life is being tortured in hell?
What?
No, not hell exactly. It's called Slell.
What the fuck?
Joe, you remember that Lucy was a rather enthusiastic proponent of the SLE program over at Stanford, yes?
And that thing where they taught college kids how to be pretentious fucks?
Precisely. Yeah. Well, after her death, Lucy did something revolutionary. She officially became the first SLE alum to have her work added to SLE's curriculum.
She made the syllabus?
Yes, look here. Her work is being studied in the spring, right after Nietzsche's The Gay Science 2, In Space!
So why does that matter now that she's dead?
Joe, when someone becomes a SLE author, they are subjected to a fine-tuned judgment. Almost every author commits some kind of terrible sin, and so they are sent to Slell to be tormented for whatever it is that made their text annoying. If they are judged to be just barely good enough, they are sent to Slurgatory. And on the off chance that they're actually blameless and every student loves them... they're sent to Slevin.
Damn it, do the sleep puns ever stop?
Certainly not.
So that's where Lucy is. Slell?
Yes, and I can help you get her back.
How? And what's in it for you?
You see, Joe, I'm not happy about it. But upon my being added to the SLE syllabus, I was sad to learn that all of my piety would not prevent me from being condemned to suffer in Slell. I was accused of body shaming, and talking about pears too much. Fixating on minuscule deeds lacking in moral quality that don't actually have anything to do with one's overall moral character and from which no nuanced conclusions about human nature can actually be drawn. But I've been offered a brief respite. I have received word from Slevin that if I aid you on your quest to restore Lucy to the land of the living, I will be allowed to leave my place of torment and enter Slurgatory.
Okay, so you know exactly where Lucy is?
Not exactly, only that she is in Slough. I pledge to guide you through every circle until we find her and rescue her.
Then, let's do it. Lucy, I'm coming for you!
Wrong direction.
Right. Lucy! I'm coming for you! How do we get to Slough again?
Ah, first, we must get into the mindset of a Slee lecturer. Now, do as I say. Rotate your torso 90 degrees, and tilt backward while leaning your neck towards the floor.
Okay.
Now, you must proceed to move yourself in a motion that is both circular and rectilinear. Up one's own ass.
Whoa.
Yeah? Yeah?
Whoa!
Well, here we are. Welcome to Slough.
This is it?
Yep.
Well, where's the gate?
The budget was only $50.
Oh.
But trouble yourself no longer with these questions, my son. Watch and observe as Minos sorts these annoying writers into their damnations.
All right, folks, listen up. As you all know, you have been added back to this year's Slee syllabus. You may or may not have been out of the game for a while, but you should know the drill by now. So, that being said, I don't want any funny business. You know, I've been down here too long to be fooled. Now, when I call your name, please step forward so I can assign you to your circle. A. Rostodoli. A. Rostodoli in the house today.
I told you before it's Aristotle.
Oh, okay, okay. I guess A. Rostodoli thinks he's a funny man. Shut the hell up. The only way I'm going to say your name is the right way. Get your ass on the circle, too.
Who's the natural slave now?
Next we have a Rini Descarty. Is Descartes in the house today? No Descartes today?
Do you mean Descartes?
Okay. I guess Descartes tried to test his limits today, huh?
There is no Descartes here.
I'm looking at Descartes right now.
How do you know?
How do you know not?
I think therefore I am pronounced Deca.
That's right. Deca. Well, I have a question for you then. How do you know that it's you that is thinking?
Because God?
No. You're bullshit and you know it. Get over it. Will I am Shaka Spray. Where the hell is Shaka Spray? I swear to the Lord Greg above, one of y'all tries to give me some silly ass name.
My Lord, the foolish whore.
Boy, I said your name about three times. Why the hell did you ask me the first time I asked you?
Perchance you hear to my finding true is truth, that my name is pronounced as Shakespeare.
pursue. Shut the hell up.
You know I have the power to send you straight to Circle 9, right? Is that what you want?
Proceed, no!
You sure? You don't want me down there with cell crates? Cell crates.
Perhaps you mean Socrates?
That's it! Circle 9. Aurelius? Is that you?
Sir, I told you that I prefer my given title of Saint August.
I know what your name is, boy. Don't act like he's in charge down here. This here is Lil, not no hair garden. Who's this here with you?
This is Joe. I'm here to escort him to the one location of one Lucy Stratford. Do you know where we might find her?
Nah, don't know nothing about no Lucy. You got any documentation?
Straight from Slevin. I've been directed to escort this young pilgrim to rescue Lucy from her realm of torment.
Well, Lysistrata 2 in space is listed on this year's syllabus, but I'm not seeing a Lucy listed in any of the circles.
But if Lucy is stuck down here, then that means there's some brave flaw in the script. I mean, every circle is a particular sin, right? If we find the sin, we can find where she's being held. What sin did she commit when she wrote that play?
Hell if I know, man. I didn't even finish reading the damn thing. It was so bad. Yeah, every one of them, for all I know.
But if it was so bad, then why is she here?
What do you mean?
I mean, I thought you had to write something good to be in Slee.
Oh, man. Man, that's a good one. Well, good luck finding this Lucy gal, but unfortunately I gotta go. Nothing good comes to those who keep the Dark Lord waiting. Adios.
Come along, Joe. You have much to learn.
Schleiermacher, Circle 4.
Yeah.
To the first circle, the circle of volume.
Volume? What kind?
Lucy? Lucy Stratford?
I'm confused. You mean volume like... Lucy? She didn't have that volume.
Volume like a shit ton of works that takes a really long time to read and is not even that concise. Oh, look, there's Socrates.
Well, technically speaking, I didn't write anything down.
Socrates, Plato, same difference.
Have you seen anyone named Lucy?
Who is that?
Well, she's this girl, and she means a lot to me, and she has to be down here somewhere.
You don't have to make up a girl just to debate. I did that once, and it went horribly. My old flame walked in, he was shit-faced. But anyways, you had something to say about the nature of bullshit.
I didn't make her up, she's real!
Are you in love with her?
Yes!
And she's a real person, not some abstract idea of love? Oh, you're very low on the ladder, young man. With this Lucy person, you'd only be able to birth humans. You must climb up, up, up the ladder until you can give birth to the purest wisdom. I want to find something to eat.
Is there anyone else in this circle besides Socrates?
No, but only because Socrates has so much volume he fills up the entire circle. Let's move on.
Welcome, everyone, to the 5/4/20th round of the Second Circle's debate on slavery. I'll be serving as your moderator as part of my community service from Slurgatory. Apparently, I can't say that Turks aren't human. But we all already know what's going to happen, so let's just get this thing started. Aristotle, would you like to give an opening statement?
Oh, dear.
Gentlemen of the circle, what you have to understand is that slavery's not really that bad. You see, everyone has different capacities of freedom. Some people are better at being cool and free and rational, like the Greeks. And some people, like Persians, are shit at it. In fact, with certain people, it's natural. I mean, even ethical to make them slaves, right?
And if those certain people all happen to be from one conveniently located continent that we can colonize, with a certain skin tone that makes it easy to differentiate them from us enlightened champions of Christendom, then that is just more efficient in the long run. In fact, we'd be civilizing them.
What circle is this?
This is the circle of bigotry. The most pleasant of all the circles of swell.
Senor Locke, do you have a rebuttal?
Yes, Mister of the Houses. Gentlemen, the bigotry that these men are expressing is the exact type of inequality that I'm trying to combat. Everyone should be equal.
Well, he doesn't seem that bad. Why is he even in the circle?
I mean, slavery as a concept is impossible. What rational man would ever sell themselves into slavery and give up their natural rights? I mean, the Jews do it. But do they really count? The truth of the matter is that all men should be equal in all regards. Except, of course, allowing people to hoard as much wealth as they want. But that doesn't harm anyone, ever.
The only inequality should be the natural inequality of man. Like, if you're a dumb asshole like Voltaire, you should be less successful than a wise philosopher like me. However, I do not think he should be a slave.
No man should be a slave.
And yeah, it's not like we're women.
That is true. Man, imagine if we had to be women.
Well, there is a place for women. As mothers.
Gentlemen, gentlemen, we're getting off topic. We aren't debating women's rights until Tuesday. Anyways, looks like we have a few visitors. Would either of you like to speak on this issue?
Well, I just think that all of you are ignoring the essential equality of all people. Not just white men, in fact. A wise man once said, all men are created equal. And if that man were here today, I think he'd have some strong words for all of you.
Actually, I have some prepared remarks from Mr. Jefferson. I find that all blacks are as incapable as children.
Okay, let's get out of here.
Welcome to confusion. Greetings. Have any of you seen Lucy Stratford?
Greetings. I'm Rumi. Are you in love with Red?
What? No, I mostly just love.
Is your milk not succulent enough?
Yes.
No. No.
Do you wish your soul were drenched with daffodils?
Yes!
Fasting!
Well, as it happens, I already...
I know you want your soul to and I know you want the king of 200 clients to crown your head!
That sounds amazing!
Hey, excuse me, we're really not interested in fasting right now.
Hello, does anyone know where Lucy Stratford is?
I know where Lucy Stratford is. Lucy Stratford is but a tree in a golden...
God! I can't bang a tree! What have you done to her?
Well, you see, there was this fish and it was like 4,000 million miles long. Sometimes it turned into like a bird. And one day, that fish saw a tree. I thought that Lucy looked like that. So, like, yeah.
Go, no!
If you're feeling down, there's a certain sweetness to the low blood sugar of the past. Don't worry, Joe. Your Lucy's okay. What about you, Sappho? Have you thought about fasting?
You brave.
Don't worry, Joe. We're here for you.
Oh, thank goodness. Someone rational. Oh. Hi.
Oh. Don't mind me. I'm just here carrying out God's will.
Really? I'm doing that too.
Have visions?
Yes, they're beautiful.
I know! I was blinded by his light. The Godhead is so blazing hot. All the fires of the heavens and the saints glow of it.
Merely glimpsing, but a privilege.
And I came into the invisible chamber of God.
Where he gave me comfort.
And then he asked me to take off my clothes.
I'm sorry, what?
And then I said, talk dirty to me. He told me to cast off fear and shame and all external virtues. And then we surrendered to each other ourselves.
What?
And then he took my boundless desire and fulfilled it forever with his limitless lavishing.
All powerful, all good, holy father, right?
All powerful is right.
Please never talk to me again.
We stand by our guarantee that if within 30 days of flailing upside down and downside up within the sea, you do not reach the pearl of fasting, we will bake your work afresh with the harvest of fasting.
Look at me, even for a moment. No speaking is left in me.
Look, do you know anything?
I would lead to the dewy lotus banks, high on the highest branch, where the purple flower, the fragment ends here.
We're out here.
Where's Lucy? I believe I have a solution for you.
You know where Lucy is? And she isn't a tree!
Oh no, she isn't a tree. She can't possibly be a tree, because form is happiness. Happiness is form.
But you just said that she was a tree!
Yes, but wisdom is ignorance. And ignorant.
Celery.
In the fall, you will go to a useless tree and find the river flow of life.
If not, winter.
Come on, Joe. We're leaving.
Blind people's souls to universal harmony?
Go away, Sophie. Come on, Joe. Well, the fourth circle is supposed to be the circle of obscurity, but I can't seem to find it. Even the slow searchable math is not being very helpful.
Yeah, the only name it shows is
Freddy Scalamander. Or Fred Schematics?
Oh, Schleiermacher!
Do you know who that is?
Yeah, yeah, he's some two-bit theologian. Met him at a conference once, I think? Let's get out of here before we get sucked into some meandering speech on nature or something.
Augustine, my man!
Hi.
Nah, man, I told you, just call me Freddy. I'm not one of those stuck-up Orthodox guys. I just think we all need to chill out and listen to ourselves before our own consciousness. You know?
Yeah, I think.
Anyways, Gusty, what brings you to the fourth circle of obscurity?
I'm just chilling here because of some bureaucratic mistake. I mean, who hasn't heard of me?
Who are you?
Look, Gus, can you please explain to your friend just how important I am to Christian theology?
Yeah, sure. Joe, Friedrich was, Freddy was, very important to something about Christian stuff in the 1800s.
Oh. So you don't remember me, huh?
Look, Freddy, it's not that...
get no respect here! You simpletons don't even know the most important Christian theologian of all time!
Well...
Second most important Christian theologian of all time!
What about Aquinas?
Third most important Christian theologian of all time!
Luther too.
Okay, look, I really feel like I haven't been afforded the respect due to being the fourth most important Christian theologian of all time.
Honestly, I'm not really an expert here, but John Calvin, he was like super important.
Jesus Christ, not Calvin again!
Hey, Mr. Shoemaker! I'm sorry!
Forget it. We've got more important circles to get to. Insecurity. The sin so annoying that even fictional characters who do it are damned.
Just another thing you can do with fictions.
Not that many people. I mean, you don't really get to be in the Slee syllabus by being insecure. Yeah, not many insecure Slee people.
But what about... Oh, right. None at all. Oh, look, Alcibiades and Paul.
And so then I was like, yes, Socrates, yes!
Are you sure that was a good idea?
Yeah, I mean, I was pretty plastered at the time. I wouldn't do it normally, but you know how it is. When I'm alone, I go back to my old ways. But when I'm with him, I can't prove that he is wrong when he tells me what I should do to him.
Such an act that blurs the grace and blush of modesty, calls virtue a hypocrite, takes off the rose from the fervent head of an innocent love.
Wait, it does? Shit, that's gonna be a problem.
Righteous angry Hamlet. Check.
Hamlet, are you doing the actor's persona thing again?
Not a whit. There's a special providence in the fall of a sparrow. If it be now, it's not to come. If it be not to come, it will be now. But lives in providence, Hamlet? Check.
Hamlet, you have to stop practicing on us. You have to respect other people's time.
The guy who writes letters that need a separate bookbinding.
Hey, I can will what is right, but I cannot do it.
It's almost like Alcibiades and Paul have the same problem.
Do you guys know where Lucy Stratford is?
My excellent good friend, how dost thou dost, Augustine? And thy friend Joe, how dost thou both? Augustine, I haven't seen your visage in this circle yet.
Yeah, you have not seen Lucy. Okay, Joe, come on now.
Friendly Hamlet,
Chad.
This is the circle of inconsistency. Here, you'll find Frenchmen like Michel de Montaigne.
Nice to meet you.
René Descartes.
Nice and thin, like wax.
Socrates should be around here somewhere. Anybody see him?
Wait, is Socrates really inconsistent? No, I really do think it's worth debating. Let's conduct a poll. Right now. Is the irreverent, disobedient, Socrates, the apology, inconsistent, the Socrates, the quito? Raise your hand if you think yes.
Oh, mon dieu!
I have it! Okay. Raise your hand if you think no! The people have spoken. Okay, now we just gerrymander the people such that more groups think no.
Did we just invent American democracy?
Also, did I ever tell you about how cold may remain an argument?
That is completely irrelevant. You just changed the subject. Did you see how he just changed the subject?
I'm the calmness, but sometimes people are stupid. They say stupid things, and it makes me so mad. So mad!
Wait, didn't you say that you stay calm?
Also, sometimes people make the stupidest, most circular argument you can imagine. So many circles, it makes me feel like I'm in, qu'est-ce que c'est? Hell!
If you think it is circular, then you're an atheist!
I don't really care if Socrates is inconsistent! I just want to find Lucy!
Oh, there he is. Are you trying to break this Lucy out of Slell? Have you considered that by entering Slell, you've agreed to abide by its laws?
What laws?!
Dead people must stay dead. No backseat. I can demonstrate. This is the laws.
Hello, I am the laws.
Laws, what would you say if someone tried to break someone out of Slow?
I would say you are breaking the agreements that you made without pressure of time, of deliberation, or compulsion, or deceit. You have had 30 minutes in which you could have left, but you did not go to Sparta, or Crete, or Berkeley. Here you are in Slough.
Well put, Laws. You see, it is not just to break Lucy out of Slough.
Yes, by Zeus, Socrates, you are right.
We have to keep going.
If you leave after breaking our commitment to us, we shall be angry with you.
Very angry. Trent, I'm gonna go find something to eat. Oh, no you don't. We had said we were gonna lose some weight. Make your commitments to us and find food. Okay, fine.
Oh my god.
Dinner with my friend Andre once. It was really long and not very interesting. Which is why I think I'll recount the whole thing to you, leaving out no detail.
And then
Noah had three sons, and each of his three sons had three sons, and everybody lived until they were 4,000 years old, and then they had fourfold more sons than not anybody had had before them.
Spirit is to be tested by spirit, flesh by flesh, earth by water, fire by cold, fight by resistance, good by evil, hard duty by deformity, poverty by riches, sweetness by bitterness, health by sickness, noon by short, hard by soft, light by death, light by darkness, life by death, paradise by punishments, the heavenly kingdom by Gehenna, earthly things by earthly things, and heavenly things by heavenly things.
This is the circle of monotony.
How come I can't hear what anybody is saying?
I mean, it's all so boring that it might as well be unintelligible.
This one.
He's talking about some dinner with Audrey.
Maybe it's breakfast at Tiffany's? Joe, come on. Lucy's obviously not here. We're wasting our time.
Ah, Lucy. She dwelt among the untrodden ways, beside the springs of Dove. A maid whom there were none to praise, and very few to love.
Oh. He may go on like he's some Wordsworth, but we all know what he and Lucy were always up to. They were... Man, I can't stand him going on like this. But no matter. Soon I'll be rid of him. Soon.
She lived unknown. And few could know when Lucy ceased to be.
But she is in her grave. And oh, what difference it is to me!
Enough! Get a hold of yourself. We're going.
Wait. They're saying something.
Let's go.
Secret circle.
Let's go.
Secret circle.
Is the circle of being someone who constantly name drops and is kind of preachy and actually gets kind of petty about it. And really, dude, if you wanted to write a memoir, why didn't you just write a memoir? Honestly, your whole shit's roughly 33% too long. Why didn't you hire an editor? But that's kind of long, so we call it being an Italian.
What did these guys ever have against you?
I've had some bad experiences with Roman students. It's enough. Let's go.
Wait, hey! Have you seen Lucy?
Lucy is the Ratford. Is she one of those rich Genoans?
No, she's Irish.
Really? Like a hymn?
Yeah, kind of.
No, I have not seen such a thing. No.
Are you sure?
Always to that truth, which at the face of a falsehood, one should close one's lips as long as one can, for without a guilt it brings a shame.
Did someone say truth which has the face of falsehood?
No!
Oh, okay.
As I was saying, I swear to your listener, listen by the notes of this play, so they may not fail to find a long favor. That I, through that thick, dark air, did not see this Lucy at all. Not even a little bit. You have to believe me.
Oh, God. Is there any other
Italian who constantly name drops and is kind of preachy and actually gets kind of petty about it and talking really dude, if you wanted to write a memoir, didn't you just write a memoir? And honestly, your whole shit's roughly 33% too long, and why didn't you hire an editor? Around here?
Let's go! I'm a Mario! I mean the Machiavelli!
Hi, I'm Joe Dandy!
So nice to meet you! How can I help you?
See, I'm on this mission to save my beloved from damnation!
Oh, that's a wonderful cause!
Joe, let's go!
Hello, sir. Is there something wrong? I have to say, you're looking quite good today.
We don't need your lies, Machiavelli. Come on, Joe.
Lies? What are you talking about? I'm just trying to be friendly and helpful.
No, you're manipulating me right now.
No, seriously. I just want to help. What's the person's name?
Lucy.
We're not telling you anything.
Oh, jeez. It's about the book, isn't it? You know that was a satire, right? Well, now this I know Lucy. She's in the 10th circle.
What's the 10th circle?
There is no 10th circle. Come on, let's go.
Why doesn't nobody want to be a friend with me?
Have you thought about changing your resume to make it shorter than a one page? Maybe that would help.
To the point.
Excuse me, but you see my
Welcome, pilgrim, to the ultimate circle of ultimate slam nation. The circle of bullshittery. Where the most obnoxious of all Slee authors reside, forever tormented.
But what is bullshit?
No, that's not what we were really trying to...
No, young man, what do you mean when you say bullshit? Is it the literal shit of bulls? Does it apply to horses as well? Such a definition seems incomplete.
I guess I was bullshitting a bit earlier when
No, that's just an example of bullshit. You're not giving me a definition.
I'm just saying that the list I have, given to me by God, says that this is the circle of the bullshitters.
I mean, you can't trust the gods. Is pious pious because God loves pious?
Isn't that Jay-Z?
To understand bullshittery in practice, we must understand the true nature of bullshittery.
Hey, did I hear someone mention bullshit? Because you have to understand there are a couple levels to understanding true bullshit.
Who are you?
You don't... know me?
No, really, what's your name, man?
Alexander Navarro. Alexander Navarro. And there are a million things I haven't said, but just you wait, just you wait. But actually, we can just get that started now. Sit down. This is an electric. Well, to understand bullshit, not just at a surface level, but at its core, its burning, molten core, we must understand what the bullshitter is doing when he, or she, of course, is birthing bullshit, is causing these grand sentences to fall like newborns through the air into our midst. These symphonies of words that meld the insubstantial and the substantial. The words, words, words. That's from Hamlet, by the way. Building. Something greater. Something that kindles the pure primal fire of the human soul. Oh, that's very chic. The part of all of us that thinks that we can be artists. Artists of bullshit, of course. But bullshit is not easy. Bullshit is perhaps the definitive exercise of the human animal, a gestalt among gestalts. When we look at one of the great works of bullshit of our time, what stands out most to us is not each individual word, but the climactic convergence of tangible and intangible experience. that makes up hearing this chaotic convulsion of sentences and ideas and lines and imagery and circle jerks that all meld together into something ineffable. Yet it's another layer of bullshit on top of this basal layer of bullshit to just claim something effable in that ineffability. Ergo recursion, ergo beauty. Is in the inexplicable, is in the thing that comes close to understanding but then kisses off the glass, ricocheting in your consciousness before kicking out again. It's just like football. For those moments of perfection, wherever they may lie, even if it's in a home run. For example, consider Socrates.
Now, hold on a second.
No, not you, but Socrates as a painting, Socrates as a Rothko in the chapel, as this massive, imperious thing bearing down upon you with the full force of the bullshit which it has concocted, which it has orchestrated.
No, that's where you're wrong. I'm not a bullshitter, I'm a truth teller. They put me to death for being too good at telling the truth. You're the bullshitter.
No, I'm the truth teller. I'm the only one who can see the true nature of art of bullshit. Not everyone can be an artist, or an art historian for that matter. There are people these days that they claim that the Lord of the Rings is art, and that's ridiculous.
Well, the Return of the Kings was a very well-executed fantasy epic.
No, fools like you claim there's artistic merit there, but that's...
I can't take this shit anymore!
Is he back with Lucy? Oh, take her in my arms. Smell her hair. We can go back to our place and...
Enough! I've had enough of you going on about having sex with Lucy.
What?
You have clouded your vision with the fog of lustfulness, the mist of thirst, the irregular cloud formation of horniness, the torrential downpour of shameful desire, the sexual perversion that portrays moving bodies as disgusting porn.
Wait! Come back! I don't know where to go!
You are staying right there, you perverted little shit!
What have I done to you?
From down in Slell, I saw your life was full of lust. Intercourse seemed not a want, it seemed a must. And when I saw you full of sin, my horror grew within. I told myself these wretched acts, they cannot stand. I will eliminate this scourge to God's great plan. I'll trap Joe down in Slell, and there he will have no more sex. But my joy is now eternal pain, no more sex. Now hellish torments lie where Lucy might have lain, no more sex, no more sex.
Secret circle jerk.
Secret circle, jerk.
Nobody ever told me about that.
It's a secret. As a wise man once said, the way which the superior man follows goes both wide and far. Common dumbasses may intermeddle with it once in a while, but at its core, there is that which even the sage does not know. Duh.
I will not make that.
Let's look at the Dante the poet, Dante the pilgrim type club. Where do you think we can see the significance of this distinction? Or where might it be blurred somewhat?
Well, insofar as Dante the poet and Dante the pilgrim are distinct, how do we reconcile the fact that they have the same name?
Well, I mean, not exactly the same. The poet is called Dante Alighieri, and the pilgrim is called Dante
Quattrofromaggi, right?
Yeah, I think so.
I'm hungry. When do we eat?
Food is a poison. When you've been a section leader as long as I have, you transcend food and you're on a higher level than that or your students.
Well, I think we have to look at the original Greek, because what we translate today as circle jerk actually stems from the Greek word spaghetti, Marionis, which means people jerking in a circle. And when you think about what the ancient Greeks thought about circles.
Well, speaking of circles, if we look at the entire book, it's a metaphor for a spiral, which is sort of a circle if you look at it from the top.
I don't think you can reconcile the false dichotomy you create between a circle and a spiral. Inherently, a spiral is a certain...
Wait, let me just say, like, one little thing. I think we have to add complexity to this notion of the relational hierarchy between the pilgrim and Virgil, insofar as the pilgrim's assertion of subjectivity relies on redirecting his anxiety about his relationship with God for an effective investment in the suffering of the victims who they confront.
Well, I think we also have to consider the overall political situation of late medieval Florence, which I coincidentally learned a lot about in my IB history.
Well, that's not really within the scope of this course, and of course we have to avoid committing the intentional fallacy. No author has really ever intended for a text to mean anything.
How does this relate to the work as a whole?
Oh, that's easy. I think we need to problematize the premise behind our question, which presumes that there is a unified, singular text.
But what is a text? Now, never mind.
Okay. To which we can reduce Dante's Inferno. Rather, I think that an intertextual analysis of the work would reveal the multiplicities inherent, which subvert any reading of the text that sees it as unified. These multiplicities,
I think, Dante's problem is that in the entire city of
Did somebody say entire city?
Students?
When we think about justice, must imagine an entire city. Something pious. Is it only because the god likes piety? I'm stuck in Slough, but the laws, the laws, the laws, they keep me from running. I am the wisest, for I know that 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 I know.
So, Lucy is in here somewhere?
She must be.
Hey, have you seen Lucy?
There's a living human in the circle!
But how do we reconcile the fact that there is a living human inside of this circle?
Well, let's not get too off topic now.
I think you're making a false dichotomy between living and non-living. In reality, the distinction's arbitrary and perpetuates an entirely Western conception, which itself is a European, hetero, cis-Norman.
You've been complaining about false dichotomies this entire quarter, but have you reconciled them once? I didn't think so.
It's a false dichotomy.
Well, reconcile it already.
I have an idea.
Do you guys have a page number?
Please! I'm looking for Lucy Stratford.
Oh, I think it's on page 44, right after Blue Dress Code Teeny.
No! She's a real person!
Okay, see this? This is a symptom of the cis hetero patriarchy. Immediately assume any female must not be a real person, and only a device meant to.
Please! Can't you help me?
Well, I can will what is right, but I cannot do it.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Can't anyone help me? Lucy! Lucy!
Joe!
I can't believe you found me. Let's get out of here.
Yes, let's.
Stop right there. That is not the real Lucy Stratford.
You asshole, Confucius.
Attack a question from the wrong end? That is harmful indeed.
I'm tired of your nonsense, Confucius.
A gentleman is not a pot.
Joe, Jack, you will never leave Slough.
Oh, no.
Quick, Joe, the pears.
What about those apples over?
Just the pears.
Pears.
Wow. A good man's trials bear fruit. That is goodness indeed.
Joe!
Lucy!
Joe!
Wait. Is that you?
What are you doing?
Never mind. Let's get out of here.
But how?
To get to the surface, you must pass through Satan's anus.
Is that a metaphor?
No, it's right there.
Reconcile! Reconcile! Reconcile!
One,
reconcile!
Two,
reconcile!
Three,
reconcile!
Three,
reconcile! Reconcile!
Okay, let's break for now. Don't forget your reading for next week, The Gay Science 2.
In space!
Please post a question to the wiki by Wednesday.
Hey everybody. Since you're all here together at the same time, I have a quick announcement about the spring syllabus. I found a mistake. We're not going to be reading Lucinda Stratford's *Lys Estrada 2 in space. So instead, we're going to read Friedrich Nietzsche's *Thus Spake Zarathustra 2 in space. The bookstore has ordered it. And on Monday, there's going to be yoga. Mats are provided. Beginners are always welcome.
Not to live.